1914. War erupts across Europe and the Middle East. Across Australia, the call to arms is sounded. A call to adventure in defence of the empire. A grand struggle to prove the worth of our new nation. No one who enlisted in the newly formed Australian Imperial Force knew what lay before them. A brutal war, like none other fought before. A war to end all wars. At home, families waved farewell to their sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, husbands and pals, and then waited. All inquiries regarding the men and women who had left Australia were sent to base records at Victoria Barracks in Melbourne. On average, more than 1,000 letters per day were received from families and friends anxious for news.
August 26, 1915. Care of Mrs. Della, Little Street, Kelvin Grove. Dear Major Pendlebury, I, Mrs. Sweeper, strongly protest against my husband John Sweeper going abroad or out of the country. My health is failing since the enlistment of my husband, and something must be done towards the matter. He's the only one I have in the world, and I want him not to leave me. I oblige. Yours respectively, Mrs. Sweeper.
By the end of the war, base records had sent out nearly 1.5 million letters, 170,000 telegrams and cables. Almost all of them were signed by the officer in charge, Major James Malcolm Lean. He carried the grief of a nation.
October 10th. 1914, Kimona, Kelvin Grove, Brisbane. This is to certify that I give my consent to my son Carl Douglas Coffin joining the 2nd Expeditionary Force. Signed, Ida Coffin.
Oxley, near Brisbane, 7th of February, 1916. To the officer in charge, base records. Dear Sir, I've been informed by Colonel Ferguson, officer in charge of 26th Battalion, and also by Sergeant Bigelow, that my son, Sergeant William Henry Cooling, was wounded on the 21st of October, 1915, and died the next day, October the 22nd. This satisfies me, but the bank requires an official certificate of the exact date. And as I had sent them October the 22nd as the date, and your certificate said September the 22nd, the two did not agree. Enclosed is the last letter received by his aunt from my son. Please return it, as we value his last letter. Yours truly, Mrs. H. Cooling.
Witnesses saw soldier killed at Pozieres on August 12, 1916. He had just returned to the trenches from fatigue duty when a shell exploded, blowing him to pieces. It was impossible for him to be buried.
December 10, 1916. To Major J. M. Lean, Base Records. Dear Sir, would you kindly let me know if my son, Private J.A. Fury, number 4501, 47th Battalion A Company, who was reported wounded in France 14 September, is still in hospital and where? We have had no word of any kind since, have cabled through the Red Cross to London but failed to get a satisfactory reply. As he is a lad that always wrote home regularly, I am very anxious concerning him.
24th of June, 1929. To Mrs. Elizabeth Fury, Sydney Street, New Farm, Brisbane, Queensland. Dear Madam, investigations are being made by the Imperial War Graves Commission with a view to establishing the identity of two unknown Australian soldiers whose remains have recently been exhumed in the vicinity of Pozieres and reinterred in Zaire Road Cemetery No. 2, situated near Beaumont Hamel, France. A silver wristlet watch and upper denture were recovered at the time, and there were also found in the grave, separate from the bodies, a razor marked J.A.F. These initials, it is thought, may possibly refer to your son, the late number 4501, Private J.A. Fury, 47th Battalion, who was reported killed in action at Pozieres, and it is order that no effort be spared in furthering the Commission's inquiries. I should be glad to be informed whether you have any recollection on the above-named soldier, having been in possession of either a false upper denture or silver wristlet watch, and in the case of the latter, a description should be furnished, if possible, in order that the question of ownership may be satisfactorily determined. Thanking you in anticipation of the favour of a reply at your earliest convenience. Yours faithfully, Major J. M. Lean, Officer in Charge, Base Records.
We are played out. A month in the trenches without a spell. And then long marches. But remember our motto. Trust in God and do the right.
October 17th, 1917. Kenholm, Granville Street, West End, South Brisbane. To the officer in charge, Base Records. Dear Sir, I've been advised by the Red Cross in Brisbane to apply to you for 2955 Private H.A. Aberdeen of the 747th Battalion, Australian Imperial Forces, personal belongings and his disc. He died of wounds at the Red Cross casualty station in France on June 10th, 1917. I, Emily Alice Aberdeen, mother, will be very grateful if you'll help me secure these precious belongings, all that is left of my son. Yours very sincerely, E.A. Aberdeen.
Dear Sir, with reference to your inquiries in the Brisbane Courier of 1st January 1921, re next of kin of the late number 2319, Private S.J. Greer, 42nd Battalion, I may state that I am the widow of late Private S.J. Greer and reside at the above address. Yours faithfully, Margaret Greer.
September 5, 1921, Fairfield Road, South Brisbane. Officer in charge, the Base Records, Victoria Barracks, Melbourne. My son, Vernon Eustace Morse, number 2706, was last seen alive by his twin brother, Private Oswald Hector Morse of the 42nd Battalion, who was with him when he fell, going down the slope of Passchendaele Ridge. I have enclosed the only reliable information I received from the Red Cross. Mrs. Mary Morse.
Morse was in C Company on October the 4th at Zonbeck. About 6:30 a.m. we had only gone some 300 yards when he had his leg taken off by a shell. He was a little man, about 5'2" or 5'3", clean shaven, rather wide mouth and with a slight peculiarity in speech. As a twin brother in the transport section.
At Passchendaele Ridge on the 4th of October, we went over the top at 6 o'clock a.m. I was 100 yards away from Morse when he was hit by a shell burst. His leg was badly smashed. His twin brother Oswald told me about 8 weeks later that he had died of wounds in hospital. Vernon was known as Snowy. He spoke with a lisp, through being somewhat tongue-tied.
The last I saw of him was just before the 4th of October. Sorry to say we were in the line then and somehow we got separated and I have no definitive word about him. I have heard he was wounded and again I heard that he was killed. Well, to tell the truth, I've given up all hope of ever seeing him again.
August 23rd, 1921. To Mr. E. Morse, Fairfield Road, Fairfield South, Brisbane. Dear Sir, I regret very much that, notwithstanding the efforts of our Graves Services Unit, we have so far been unable to obtain any trace of the last resting place of your son, the late number 2706, Private V. E. Morse, 42nd Battalion. Yours faithfully, Major J. M. Lean, Officer in Charge, Base Records.
To Major J. M. Lean. Dear Sir, in reference to your letter of 26th April concerning the disposal of war medals of my late son, number 2955, Private H. A. Aberdeen. The father of the above named is still alive. His address is H. H. Aberdeen, Orley Terrace, Hill End, South Brisbane. But as I have not had a legal separation from my husband, which was the wish of my late son, above named, I consider his medal would be more appreciated by me under the circumstances. Yours faithfully, Alice Emily Aberdeen, mother of Private H. A. Aberdeen, Granville Street, West End, South Brisbane.
July the 11th, 1921, to Major J. M. Lean, Victoria Barracks, Melbourne. Dear Sir, I beg to acknowledge receipt of yours of the first instant. I note that you wish to know if I have any objection to handing over the medal of my son, number 2955 H.A. Aberdeen, to his mother. In reply, I beg to state that I am distinctly opposed to any such proceedings, as I am in myself next of kin and head of the family. I am, yours respectfully, H.H. Aberdeen.
To Major J. M. Lean, the officer in charge. Dear Sir, I'm very thankful to have received some of the personal effects of my darling son, late number 2955, Private H. A. Aberdeen, 747th Battalion.
September the 19th, 1921. J. M. Lean, Esquire, Military Records Office, Melbourne. Dear Sir, in reply to yours of the 13th concerning my son's war medals, I still say that I am entitled to them and expect to receive them, I being his father. With reference to the legal separation, as you mentioned in your letter, I beg to inform you that this was made months after my son's death. I am, sir, yours faithfully, H. H. Aberdeen.
30th of October 1921, to Major J. M. Lean. With reference to the disposal of the war medals of my son, the late number 2955, Private H. A. Aberdeen, 47th Battalion, I thank you and all in charge for your kind consideration in deciding to distribute part of my beloved son's medals to me. I am, yours faithfully, Emily Alice Aberdeen.
Brisbane soldiers came from all walks of life. Their occupations included bakers, boot clickers, butchers, carters, carpenters, canvassers, coopers, clerks, cordial makers, drapers, hat makers, labourers. There was journalists, gaslighters, stockmen, tailors, tram conductors, teachers, tobacconists, window dressers, wall classers, and at least one actor.
Hark, the sound of thousands cheering. Hark, the tramp of soldiers' feet. See the colors proudly waving. all down the busy street. Hark, the brass band sweetly playing march tunes that we know. Goodbye, Dolly, we are leaving for the king to strike a blow. It's a long, long way across the ocean. It's a long, long way to go. With hearts so light, they'll bravely fight whene'er they meet the foe.
Jock Willis enlisted in Brisbane on the 9th of September 1915. At nearly 40 years of age and renowned on stages across Queensland and beyond as a Scottish comedian, Willis was perhaps an unusual candidate for military service in the Great War, but nothing about Willis's life might be considered usual.
Jock Willis, the comedian, convulsed the audience with his humour.
Mr. Jock Willis was chief in command of the fun department and worthily upheld his big reputation both in his songs and patter.
The front lines in France were not as appreciative as the Brisbane audiences. Lieutenant Willis was hospitalised with illness several times and returned to the lines only to receive a gunshot wound to the arm during the battles around Polygon Wood. Finally home again in Australia, he found that audiences' tastes had begun to change as well. Laughs were harder to come by, and his old glories seemed so long ago. Audiences grew smaller and smaller, but even as a fading star, Jock Willis could still make grown men cry with his rendition of Danny Boy.
Back when summer's in the meadow, and when the valleys are hushed and white with snow, 'tis I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so.
Brisbane, December 1914. Jock Willis was performing in a variety show at Earls Court Theatre in New Farm. Across the river, in South Brisbane, police clerk and would-be poet Thomas Brennan felt the call to new adventures in foreign fields.
Sir, I beg to report in reference to attached application that I regret the short notice of my request to resign given therein. The exigencies of my case require me to take my...
Palestine, 1918. Having survived Gallipoli and battles across the Sinai Peninsula, Thomas Brennan is now a quartermaster sergeant with the 5th Light Horse Field Ambulance, has been awarded the Military Medal for gallantry in the field, and is now the dedicated editor of the Cacolet, the journal of the Australian Camel Field Ambulance. With his comrades of the Light Horse Field Ambulance, he awaits casualties of battle in the Jordan Valley.
The tattered Red Cross standard, stained with mud and dye-silted rain, ran home on the flagstaff. The first of them rode in. He was swaying slightly in the saddle as he rode up the gully, blood showing through the bandages on his arm, his thigh and shin. His mate reined up the horses, dismounted and lent a hand to get him down. Leg fractured in two places. Yet somehow he rode the 1.5 miles without losing his cheerfulness. "Many in?" was his first query. On being informed he was the first, a smile broke his unshaven features and he murmured, "Well, I'm the Jonah then." So it went on, through the day and long into the night, the next day and the next night until it seemed years.
Comrade of knapsack or bandolier, tread light, we pray, when you pass this way, for sake of the brave ones slumbering here. Nameless in death to the judgment day, tread light, Lest the tramp of your martial host or rattle of rifle or bayonet blade should ring down the night to their silent post and rouse them too soon for the grand parade. Tom Brennan got the adventures he was looking for, and in the field of combat he found his voice as a poet, with his poem Our Nameless Dead being widely published in Australian newspapers in 1915. He may have found his poetical voice, but by the time the war ended, it was other voices he was hearing.
29th September 1919, Queen Alexandra Hospital, England. Throat cut. Dangerously ill, 4 incisions at the back of the neck, damaging the trapezius muscle on both sides of the neck.
13th October 1919, Lord Derby War Hospital, Warrington, England. Patient states that he has had worry about his mother's health and had been taking some alcohol, but now cut it out completely.
A quartermaster, Sergeant Brennan, was on board the transport ship Border, returning to Australia as a mental convalescent. During the voyage, he became very confused and subject to...
6th of April 1920, to the Commissioner of Police, Brisbane. Sir, I am an ex-member of the police force, having joined the AIF their form on 10th of December 1914. Prior to enlistment, I was employed on clerical work with the Criminal Investigation Branch, holding the rank of constable.
When in this office, he, Brennan, was entrusted with the very responsible work of compiling the material for publication in the Police Gazette. This he did in a very unsatisfactory manner, which seriously affected the criminal records of the whole department. The method was to secrete away in pigeonholes material for the Gazette received from different parts of the state. This was only discovered after his resignation. I can only say that Brennan's admission to this branch would not be justified. Inspector O'Sullivan, Criminal Investigation Branch, Brisbane.
Brennan's application to return to his previous duties was denied. Returning to Brisbane was harder than he could have imagined. 5 months later, he died of injuries caused from a fall off a Tank Street boarding house balcony. It was 1920, and Peter Austin had returned to Cairo for the first time since the war ended. He'd tried to convince the repatriation board to cover the cost of his passage back to Egypt so he could take up a new business opportunity as a buyer of Eastern carpets for an Adelaide-based importer. But the repatriation board was not forthcoming in its support.
6th of September 1919. It is not the policy of the repatriation department to assist returned soldiers to leave the Commonwealth. In fact, such a policy would not be repatriation.
Whilst this was disappointing, perhaps this wasn't a big surprise to Austin. After all, he hadn't been Peter Austin for very long. Peter Austin was born in South Brisbane in 1892 as Rudolf Novak Augstein. The eldest of 6 children, Rudolf completed his schooling in Brisbane and started work as a clerk in the customs office. Later, he was employed at the School of Arts as an assistant librarian. In October 1914, he enlisted in the Australian Imperial Force, and his library colleagues presented him with an engraved watch.
I guess I'll go. A cove can only die the once, and struth, it'd be worse to sit and let the others do your bit. I bet I take one of them guns. I guess I'll go. For if a bloke be chance she'd peg, what odds? We gotta die some day, and some'll live, and so I say, I'll risk a wooden arm or leg. Well, I guess I'll go.
Augstein served with the Australian Army Medical Corps First General Hospital in Egypt, Greece and France for almost 3 years before obtaining a medical discharge with a defective mitral valve in the heart in May 1917. After trying without success to obtain a repatriation scholarship to enable him to study medicine at Sydney University, Rudolf heeded the advice of a family friend and changed his foreign-sounding name by deed poll to Peter Austin late in 1917, the same year in which his father died. Under his new name, he published Bill Jim, his first volume of poems, in 1917. A second volume of poems soon followed, The Young Gods, in 1919. Reviews were generally positive, but it wasn't enough to make him stay in Brisbane. Austin needed transformation once again and left for Egypt.
If, someday, I write a book about Cairo, I shall call it The City of Desire. Throughout the day and night, desire with hot eyes sways through this city, as never in a town of the Western world. Vice is no longer shameful here. Lust is no more obscene. Like warm breaths of a live woman, always a little wind blows here. It is the breath of Egypt, hot, sentient, and lustful.
Seduced by his new life in Cairo, within 2 years, Austin became a convert to Islam and changed his name yet again, this time to Ali Azir al-Din. His career as a carpet buyer was short-lived, but he worked as a journalist and teacher. The heart condition that saw him discharged from the army stayed with him, and his health remained delicate. Leaving the home of a friend, he fell down a flight of stairs and fractured his skull. He was taken to Cairo Hospital, but never regained consciousness. There had been no new books of poetry published, and he'd never returned to Australia.
One cannot help but regret that his death made so little stir. Perhaps if it had been Peter Austin who died instead of Ali Azir al-Din, there would have been long obituary notices in the newspapers of his native land of Australia. And editors would have been preparing a re-edition of his poems, the poems he would have written, but never wrote.
Once they sang of the glory of war, poet and peasant and emperor. How shall they know of the things that are, the horror, the stink and the slime of war? Premier, governor, emperor, how shall they know all the shame of war? How can they know of the blood that drips, drips from the hollows that were once lips? What do they know of the shell that rips muscle and flesh from the cocky's lips? What do they think of the bursting shell, sending a dozen to heaven or hell? Say, have they smelt of the powder's smell, heard their best cobber's last dying yell? Know what it is to feel scared to die, scared to live with a shattered thigh, laid in the night time beneath the sky, wondering if this is to be goodbye. Oh, they talk of the glory of war. Have they seen women lie dead on the floor? Premier, governor, emperor. What do they know of the glory of war?
Lover, where do you live? In the sky, in the clouds, in the ocean. I learned the lesson about bad ideas.
Again, my love.
sky.